Have you ever wondered what your aquarium can tell you about water quality? Without a single test kit? Nature has its own way of revealing the health of an ecosystem through bioindicator species. In this video, we'll explore the fascinating creatures that can help you monitor your tank's water quality naturally. Because, well, when you look at it, does this one look any healthier than the tank next to it over here? How can you tell? Certainly can't by looking at the water, can you? Let's start off with our invertebrates. They're probably the easiest ones to figure out whether or not water quality is good or bad. And specifically, we can talk about our lovely friends, the Daphnia here. They're extremely sensitive to pollutants like heavy metals, ammonia, and even chlorine. So if they're thriving, it means that the water is well oxygenated and free from many toxins. If they vanish suddenly, it could indicate that there's an oxygen crash. Same thing with our friends like the copepods and the ostracods. If you see that they are busy doing their job, eating detritus, being food for your fish, then you have a thriving ecosystem in there. Another great invertebrate bioindicator would be shrimp. Usually they're very active, constantly grazing, and that would be a signal of great water quality. If the shrimp, however, become lethargic, pale, experience sudden die-offs, or are covered in parasites, it could mean that there could be ammonia spikes, copper contamination, or temperature stress. Excessive molting or failed molts may indicate unstable water parameters, particularly GH or KH. Next up on the list are snails. Snail shells are made out of calcium carbonate, which dissolves in acidic or soft water, so changes in the water acidity will be very apparent on their shells. Specifically, this may start when the pH drops below 7. And the lower the pH, the faster the shell will dissolve and the more you will see. Funny enough, this is an experiment that I try every year with my students, where we put seashells in varying percentages of vinegar, and anything above 60% vinegar, it dissolves completely. Sometimes they may have thin, brittle, or cracked shells. That could also be an indicator of low general hardness. Snails build their shells out of both the calcium they acquire from their food and from the water, so changes in the water will be reflected in their shells. Snails are also especially sensitive to heavy metals such as copper, and so if your snails are suddenly retreating or dying off, you may want to test for that. And also ammonia and nitrites can be a particular problem to snails as well as fish and other inhabitants of the aquarium. Also of note are the Malaysian trumpet snails, which are normally beneath the substrate, and if they are all of a sudden en masse out when they aren't normally, you may have an issue in the substrate. Even worms can be an indicator in your tank, should you have them. Some of them will end up reproducing far too much if you have too much organic matter making it into the soil. And if you start to see your worms surface in mass when you don't normally see them surface, and it's definitely not due to food, well, it could be due to the fact that your substrate may be low in oxygen and they are just trying to get some to survive. And just like the rest of our invertebrates, they can be especially sensitive to ammonia and nitrites. And here we are at fish. The one that most of you have probably noticed. Hopefully you have some sort of baseline as to what your fish's normal behavior might be. Do they swim about? Are they shy? Are they personable? What is it that they normally do? If there's something that all of a sudden is out of the blue that's a little bit different, like unfortunately my poor Daniel right here is suffering from some clamped fins, well, there might be something to investigate. So hopefully you know your fish's behavior quite well at this point. Now, of course, this could be pretty hard to suss out if you've got new fish that you're quarantining in a new tank. They might not even have their full colors yet. But the key things, of course, to look out for are things like clamped fins, gasping at the surface, being lethargic, hanging out near the bottom a lot, or loss of color, fading, or damage. And now onto greener pastures, plants and algae. Normally, plants that are fast-growing like hornwort, water wisteria, or vallisneria will indicate whether or not you have enough nutrients in your substrate and/or water column, and whether there is sufficient lighting, CO2 available, all of those great things, and those plants will grow fast. And of course, if your plants are yellowing or melting and you know that they have been in the tank for a long time and they're not freshly introduced and perhaps grown outside of the water, then you may have an issue. Same with stunted growth or curling leaves, or even algae covering the entire plant leaf. Could be an indicator of some type of stress. As far as the algae itself, well, it's your friend. Depending on what type of algae you have, you can tell exactly what your parameters are in your tank. Do you have too many nutrients? Too little nutrients? Well, it depends on the type of algae you're seeing and what's going on. It's a bit complex, and I've got some enormous charts in the book covering this. One cool trick of floating plants is that their roots will match the nutrient levels. If the roots are short, generally the nutrient levels in the water are relatively high, whereas if their roots are much longer, well, they're trying to seek out more nutrients by increasing their surface area. There are also some floaters that will only survive with high nutrient levels. There's one last thing that sometimes plants do, and they eject themselves. It is usually an indicator of poor light or poor soil conditions. Another common thing we find on the Discord channel is that people are out collecting from the wild and they wonder whether or not the water they are collecting from is clean. Well, first thing you might be able to look at is algae. If there's too much of it and it's too green, it might end up being eutrophic, which means that the nutrients in the water are too high, usually in terms of phosphorus or nitrogen. This can also mean there might be a high level of cyanotoxins from cyanobacteria present. And if you're finding nothing but algae, no motion, no living invertebrates, the water quality is probably pretty bad too. Not a good place to collect from. One fun tool that we have hosted on the Discord that I adapted from existing material was the Invertebrate Index of Water Quality. This is something that researchers have found can give you a good idea of which waters are clean and which waters are likely polluted, based on whether or not you're finding some of these organisms. All the ones currently showing right now are ones that only exist in the cleanest of waters, so if you find them, you can be pretty sure that your water quality is good. Conversely, if you're only finding these creatures, you might have bad water quality. These creatures can survive in low oxygen environments, and a lot of them have the ability to either get more oxygen by flattening their bodies or going straight to the surface to supplement. And there we have it, bioindicators. These things can tell you if your tank is going wrong and might indicate that you need to do some tests or some changes. What those changes might be, well, we'll discover those in future videos. I thank you for joining me on this journey, and if I've sparked your curiosity, maybe join us over on the Discord where you can explore further. And don't forget to leave that like, comment, maybe subscribe if you haven't already. All of those do well for supporting this channel. Thank you.